the drop. Currents out, sailing comes. We're knocking on doors, 70-pound packs off, dragging our rods about. And then that farmer, let's sort it out. And he said, yeah, you can go all over my land, do what you want. Just have to climb these big fences, like deer fences. They just put the pack down there. And he gives us this hook, free of charge. Good inside of our map of the hook. Been netted for a couple of years. The chap used to come every year, but there's at the far end of the pond, he's scared to go there because he's crossing it with his son in the boat to put his fight nets out, and an eel attacked his oar. Came right up in the water and attacked his bit of piece out of his oar, or attacked it, and he had his kids in it. The farmer said the chap came up to his house after and he's still shaking. It scared him off a bit. The story is that it sends all the eels off to another country, forget where now, and they only like the small ones. The big ones are too fatty. The landowner doesn't know what the netsman did with the big ones, but as I said, he's had some absolute massive ones in his nets here. Hopefully not all of them. We're expecting it to be booted up though, because we've just seen an eel swim past, only about 3/4 of a pound, just under the surface, into a weed bed here. There's some small fry topping. Apart from that, we just had that hunk of a trout from Peter. And the sun's just dipped, and we're hoping to see some action this evening.
What are you up to?
I've got a bell on the end of my rod, and I've got a trout's head on.
Sea fishing style.
And look at this.
Twisting the night away.
Fences. high as a deer fence though, as it takes some flaming climbing all the time. We're just pulling out of this dump. We're stuck on this ranch with massive fences. I'm sick of climbing these fences. You have to climb about 30 every time you want to go anywhere. But this has been like a stew pond full of small eels, hundreds of them. We can't get through the small ones to the big stuff. It's just too much for us. So today we're pushing on to do Wagon Creek. 3 weeks done and a week left. All our bites have come up from the sandflies. We're peppered. Just felt like a little nip when they bit us, but we didn't realise they'd come up in big septic ulcers 3 days later. Still, we cut up a pair of ladies' tights and stuck them on my hands to stop them biting my hands, and a net over my head. And we're going to go back into the forest, do battle for the last week. It's the best one, the most remote one, Wagon Creek. These are the plains at the bottom, with the hill going up at the back into the rainforest, and all the gold diggers' creek.
Just get off the bus, set off the food dump. I think there must be some massive eels in this river. There's a big deep pool which come on straight away first thing. We've got 8 days battle with the sandflies here. Further up Wagoner's Creek, right out the other side of the rainforest. Old gold miners' creek. And we reckon we'll be away from commercial netters around here. And hopefully plenty of double figure eels. I've already seen bullheads in the margins, so it's not lifeless. There's another bully just gone there.
And here we are, coming back over the 4 mile river. Yeah, we were on the wrong trail. The coach driver seems to have dropped us off on a forested path, and we're looking for the tramway track. We've found it on the map, it's about a mile away. But first of all, we spent 10 minutes crashing about the bush, trying to find the trail, but it wasn't here. 10 minutes later, looks like the tramway track. That's better, this is the one we're after. Tirupahi tram track. 4 hours a turn. Feet away to the river. This river and its tributaries. Where we're going to spend the last 8 days of the trip, from what may. We're out in the outback now, on the trail of eels. We've not got any bait yet for tonight, and it's dark in a couple of hours. So we'll try and scratch some just as it's going dark with a little pan net. Should manage it. That t-shirt! See me, eel me. Where's your hat?
My hat? In the bag.
Not in the full rainforest, this. Seems to be more of a mixed beech woodland. Which way is the water, man? It's a driller. To the right. Water diviner peak. On the slime trail. Racing against the clock. Going down. An old gold digger's track. Taking us deep through country that would be otherwise inaccessible. We've worked the way right up the top of the mountain. So, not like the limestone texture.
There's a whooping sound for the flower. Is it the sound of the weeper? Kiwi? Or another deer?
Feet's washing. Did you hang those up to dry? He says those are clean. Clean enough. Bit of eel slime never hurt anyone. The clearing on the gold diggers track. Setting night at the gold diggers track. Got an eel each last night before we got washed out. There was six bull heads led to a couple of eels, so we sorted for bait for a couple of days. New Zealand robin. Flat breast, a lot bigger than our robin. Bit like one of our great chips off. And they've broken out into open country on the gold diggers path that we're still on. Spiders nest those white things in the sea. Can you see the size of the spider?
I was just putting my rod rest in there and I thought I could see a salmon coming up the river under that log where my rod is. What it was that eel's head. And I looked and this just kept going the length of it. I could see these mottled patches on it. So I recognise it as the same one. I dropped my line straight in and just held it up like you do in the sea. Waited for it to bounce around and there we go.
How big's that one, Buzz?
9 pounds, 6 ounce. Proper bullhead, that.
It's
9 pounds, 6 ounces of mussel as well.
Personal best deal, eh?
Personal best, yeah. Best was 8 from Bullock Creek last week.
Lovely. Beauty.
9 pounds, 6 to put a bullhead on that.
Smile. Yeah, this is just a sort of log strewn sort of pool below some rapids. And that's actually where Barry spotted it, along this edge, and we had to sort of whip it out. A bit of heroics with the landing net and short, powerful bite. Barry lost a few stone. And sweat.
Stuck in the jungle getting here, wasn't it? You could hear the water, but couldn't
find it. It's that stuff.
Tell you, nothing invented, nothing gained. They earned that fish by coming through that terrain.
Yeah. There's no light in there or nothing. It's just...
I was saying, we're only doing hours fishing a day and 23 hours walking. Well, there's my hours fishing. Not really. About 10 minutes that took when we got here. Just a matter of walking to the right place.
Beauty. What sort of length have we got on that one?
42 and a half.
There's a whopper.
Yeah. Right. Yours was more, wasn't it?
Right, I'll put him back in the same bit as I caught him. I saw him coming up from under this log before I just as I was setting the rod left after we chest it. He's away.
Here we are, Mad Dog McConnell. Drinking out of his bowl. But it's the best brew he's had.
You wouldn't drink out of one of them at home. We got the cup, so I'm drinking out of the can. Just to brew it and let it cool.
Trouble is, we keep having to stop for so we can have a taste.
Got another eel after that 9-6. Just as it went dark last night.
What's we got here?
That water's warm. Warmer than the air. Anyway, here we've got another eel of 9 pounds. Might even be the same one, I want to get it on the vid. Took an eel fillet again, cast under that raft of driftwood that has now scummed up in the night. I'm just going to go and get the some more food from the food dump. And we're stopping on this river for 2 or 3 nights now, looking it around. Lively. Net job, I think. Now, could that be the same eel?
Chances are it is. It's a block to go. We'll have to see.
Well, that'll be one way of catching. Loads of nines, keep putting him back and catch him again.
Catch the same one.
It was only half an hour later, wasn't it?
That's why I didn't catch anything, because you didn't put him back, you had him in the sack.
Something that came to mind yesterday, we decided we'd done 23 hours walking. I was getting sick of it, saying, Pete, come on. We're supposed to be eel anglers. We're spending all the time hiking around with sacks of food and tents and blisters on the heels. So, after 23 hours walking, we did an hour's fishing and I got 2 9s. We could have done 23 hours fishing and an hour's walking and fish nearer to the main roads than the access points, and it's all netted out. We just get boots. So we're going to walk 46 hours this time and do half an hour's fishing. You see what we get tonight. We're going to where this river vanishes into a plug hole. The cave should be full of them if we can get there. Is that the same fish we have? Here he is, going back. One of the nines, or the nine, that we got twice. I'll put him back again where we put him back last time, or... Yep.
Having a lunch break. In fact, we decided to stop here. This is the confluence of the river we're after. That's Wagon Creek going up the other side through the jungle there. And this is the 4 mile river that we've been on that comes through this deep pool. So this is as far as we've got, this confluence pool. And I've got a massive tree on a rock with an undercut cave beneath it. The water just goes off deep, it must be over 10 feet over by that rock. Pete's got a bait in the flow just there. He fancies the blood trail coming off his bait into the flow. And that's the style we're fishing. Pete's got a cliff under his reel there, which is actually attached to his rod. And the rod sits up, keep the line out of the flow. Mine's the same sort of setup. Except I've got my socks drying on my rod. We had to wade the river to get here. Rod tip up, and that's just bait runner. Couldn't do this for our eels at home. Compared to what we're used to on the Shropshire Mears, where they won't stand any resistance. It's a joke, this. Just wait for them to pull your rod in. If you can't pull your rod in, they're a boot. So first thing tomorrow morning, we're off up Wagon Creek over there. We might have to wade up the river. Pete's rig. Piece of netting with a brick in it for the ledger. There we cast that. We just found a cave in a backwater. It's dark and deep over there and shallow on this side. The eels could be hiding there out of the sun. Yeah, Pete likes those leads. Well, leads, stones wrapped in netting or a piece of ladies' tight. Because when he gets snagged up, they just break off. Cost me a fortune in lead, and he's doing it for now. Backwater, breaking away from the main river, which is all full of good pools. There's a waterfall down there with a big rock by it. We fancy that big rock. There might be eels lay up under it. That's our next swim to try. Give it 10 minutes on this swim. Oh, here we are. With another cat. We only got two runs last night, one each. But they were both at the same time. We're packed up, we're waiting to go up over there. We're going up Bullock's Wagon Creek today, that little stream. Goes under the canopy through the jungle. Nothing to limestone country. Anyway, two runs we had. Pete was shouting for the net. And as I went to the net, my rod went. And I got one. It is the biggest. Which one have you got hold of there, Pete?
Eight ten. Yeah.
And the other was 6-8, mine. And here's where you landed yours. Luckily, he'd made himself a channel up out of the rock. And he dragged it up onto the beach here. Now, we had a proper fight from those last night. It turns out they fight better. This is a deep pool. First time we've had them in a deep pool. They fought just as much as the English ones. Bent your rod to the maximum, and then you had to move them.
Bend it even more.
Until you thought, it felt like your hook was going to straighten, didn't it, Pete?
Yeah. Thought it was just going to snap everything.
But you have to give it that much. You can move them.
In the gravel here, it was digging itself down in the gravel. In the shallow water. There's no chance. I've let it go back out again. And I had to run up the beach and the rod locked over solid.
Nice one.
Steps out
and I was just over there getting a 6.5 in the net. An hour after dark, those two runs. So there's a couple of big eels in every pool. Manage a couple like that every night. Second biggest?
Second biggest in New Zealand. I've had loads bigger than England, don't
I? Yeah, yeah, yeah. Lovely fish. 8-10 of pure muscle.
What's that? Going down, does it, Pete?
beat the Pathfinder.
There's one path going that way. And the other one is there. Don't know which to take.
Yeah. Can't go over that without a rope. That's the end of the path for me, Pete. Backtrack time through the jungle. Have a look, we're following this riverbed. And we decided to stop here. Further down, this gorge is completely covered over with ferns and canopy. It goes into real steep-sided gorge. Amazing place. But that's the end of the line for us. We're not climbers, we've got no rope.
White lighting is found. On the way back down the top of the gorge. Somewhere down there is the ravine which has come down. It's a rope job. Come through all this tangle. Can't even go a foot off the path. We'll keep losing the path, it's so faded away anyway. Potholes, it's all limestone country, caves. Now the path actually goes down into this creek and we walk over those logs somehow and follow the ravine up. What a place. We couldn't walk up the creek, it's all deep, waterfalls and pools, steep-sided gully. Wow. What's happened from this place? After that 2 hour forest hike. There's massive cracks in the ground and a limestone pavement. Yeah, there's a sinkhole at the top. Right up there. Just underneath. The road's all around there. So there's a big crack which is going to be well healed.
Look what I've got. Caught this in one of the deep pools on the way up.
Poor daddy.
Big crayfish. I'm going to use it for bait.
Where's it said?
So there's one hose up. 40 pound sea fishing line. Grey mail. I'm not even sure how to up one of them.
Through the tail.
Through the tail. There we go. Like that, getting meal and bait. Same piece of eel I caught there. Sticks on last night. Use the bait.
Fantail tip. Feet gravel, fishing in a hole in the ground. So how deep did you say it was?
About
50
yards.
50 yards deep? 150 foot deep? What, that hole in the ground?
This real one's overspilling with lime.
Yeah.
And I'm on the bottom there.
You found the bottom then? Or are you just stuck on a shelf halfway down?
Halfway down.
Bloody hell.
I tried to get off this, bounce it off the couple and I can't bounce it off this one. Might be the bottom.
How are you going to land something out of there?
Well,
lower me down with the net. Far down's the water from where you're stood. That's 6 foot. And then it's 50 yards from the surface to the bottom there.
Swing, swing.
We found that it's halfway up Wagon Creek after we'd followed the non-existent path through the jungle. We lost the path a few times. You step a foot off the path, you're down a gully like this. It's all on little flints of limestone. 2 or 3 hour walk through the jungle. Hell of an adventure. Now we're dropping it down cracks in the limestone into bottomless pits in a cave system where the river's gone underground. We're sort of sat on the top of this sort of limestone pavement. Not a bad place to take lunch. Pete catching crayfish. We've got two in that pool now, somewhere. I'm letting them start fighting or something. That's a go for you if you put your hand there.
Yeah.
Put your hand in then.
So you've got two big to go for each other, isn't it?
Beauties, they've gone red. Oh, they've gone red when I boil them. Bright pink, very mild taste.
I think I'll stick to my beef curry. Wherever it is. Looks fat and ready to go. I'm going to move up river a mile, find another pool. For some reason, I blanked on this pool last night. Can't imagine what, why. You can see, sun's on the shallows, and there's a drop off along there, over a rock ledge, into it's about 10 or 12 foot deep down the middle here. And I cast my bait against that far limestone wall and let it slide down. I could feel it going down, giving it line 10, 12 foot deep. Not a touch all night between us. Pete watches out in the big wide pool. Except it comes in from the rapid. Nothing there either. So we'll try upriver.
Anguilla, river crossing, you can do it, double figure eel at the end of the trail, go on Anguilla!
Pete's to dry off after crossing the river, Pete's had his rod set up as we were wading, and he's, this tiny little shallow pool here, he's swinging a bait into that dark patch on the other side. Just had an eel on that got off. Should take again there. Fish going.
middle of the day. Not bad, small eel. How big is it, Pete?
That's 3.5.
And that's just a boot up here? Or a strap?
Or a boot.
Or a bit of bait. I'm going off to look for a swim for tonight. It's a bit shallow around here. See the bottom all the way across. Still be big eels here, but I'm going to try and find somewhere with a bit more depth. It's 2 hours to eeling hour, 2 hours till it's dark. Light aircraft's just been over. There's our footprint from when we came up. Light aircraft's just been over. That's all I've seen in the last 7 days. Two helicopters and one light aircraft. Haven't seen a living soul. Not a single human in a whole week up here. Up out from Pete. Aha. A raft of driftwood. Being here is full of logs. Likely holding spot from here. Seems we'll have to bivvy on these massive rocks. No tailor-made swims here. When it rains, we have to move in the night because it's a straight river. Flash floods come down. So heavy rain, and we're up there in the bush. And then it'd take us days to get back rather than following this river down. It's a short cut. Hope it doesn't rain. Found a bit of open water to get a line in. Net. Looking night fish there. Yeah. Pull some logs out to make space to land an eel. The logs we're looking for. I'll have to clear a couple of bits out. Just enough room to get my net in. And then rod. You can see the bottom. No eels there at the moment. But it wouldn't surprise me if there's massive things here after dark. It'll do for me, but it's just over on the corner. There's a deep pool that Pete can do when he comes down. But I'd better run down river, see if there's anything better. A few hundred yards down. Or more.
Come down river. I'm going to wait for all the sign of creek. And we're going to fish this swim where there's a tanglement of logs.
The creek comes in on the other side. Just in. The creek lines just a field up straight away. That's where he caught it. Shallow water halfway out, just a bit darker on the other side. And we've seen a bow wave come out of that creek opposite. We knew something big had moved in the swim. Next minute, Pete's away. Well done, Pete.
Cheers.
Zero the way back on the scale. I'm like an expert. Do what?
Went straight in the
boat. Yeah.
6'9"
Brilliant. Have a little river like this.
Six
nine. Yeah.
Nearly as big as my personal best English eel. It looks a lot smaller.
Just an afternoon snack over here, that. Something to do while you're making a coffee.
And catch some over here,
straight into the weed, the driftwood raft. We've got in the raft of driftwood. That's the place we've got to look for them. That's where I got them 2 9s. Driftwood. Yeah, the thing is, the eel looks like one of them branches, doesn't it? Perfect camouflage for them getting under that lot. Last night. Suddenly heard the bell ringing, which is on this line over here, past that rod there. We've got a piece of eel attached to the line, thrown out on a stringer, attached to the rod rest, and then a bell that you attach on the end of a sea fishing rod, attached to the line. We suddenly heard that ringing an hour after dark. Eight lying on the bottom, attached to the line, which is a piece of parachute cord. And hold on, Pete. I'll get Pete to ring the bell now. That's what we heard, and that rod rest was bent double. It was trying to pull it in. So Pete grabbed the line, and the eel was on the end there, and he pulled it in slowly with the eel chasing it. Was it like a lure chasing it? We were both lamping it. It got to there. Got to about there, and we had our torches on it. And it was a massive eel. So I said to Pete, pull that stringer out, and I'll drop my bait on its nose. Drop the bait on its nose in full torchlight. It grabbed it in its mouth. And then Pete realised it's bigger than anything he'd ever caught. Bigger than the British record. So he stumped the gravel with his feet, scared it off. It shot away straight away, spat my bait out, went over there. 10 minutes later, Pete had a run on his rod there, and he was in. And there it is, in the sack. Let's have a look. What's the weight, Pete? What?8.5 by 11.25. Is that the fattest bit, that? That's the broadest bit of his head. ten and a quarter round the head. Just we're gonna have a look at that head. Can you help me jump? Yeah. Put it right up. To do badly. It gets fine as much as it looks. It's deep water again. It's a tough one to death though. Like a dolphin, then, that. Long dolphin. Very long dolphin.
Yeah.